lecture series again this year. We really appreciate this very much. Thank you, Paul. I think you can. Okay, Reinhard Schmidt, Professor Reinhard Schmidt. That was a tough one for me because he's my mentor, or one of my mentors. He's a former colleague I taught with for many years. So it was very difficult for me to come up with some kind of introduction which is a bit different. So I'm trying. And I will just start with the basics. He was educated in Weinstephan at the university, which is just outside Munich, one of the most prominent landscape programs in Germany. He graduated there in 1980. And after that, worked for 10 years for Gottfried Hans Jakob, which is a very prominent office in Munich, but which worked a lot all over Germany, so from small scale to large scale. In that time, in those 10 years, he registered with the Bavarian Chamber of Architects in 1986, and by 1991, he decided to open up his own office. At that time, he rose from an intern landscape architect in the Gottfried Hans Jakob office to the office manager. So he had a lot of experience in all kinds of projects. In 1991, he was also opening his own office with three different branches, one in Munich, one in Bernburg, and one in Berlin. And over the last 23 years, he has done any kind of work from garden design to large scales, and I've asked him, Patrick and I have asked him to talk about his city projects today and what landscape architects can do in designing cities. But it is important to also know that at the same time in 1991, he was also appointed professor in Berlin at the Beuth University of Applied Science. The Beuth University of Applied Science just changed its names over the time, but many people may not know it's the oldest institution in Germany to educate landscape architects. And it was founded by Peter Joseph Lenné, who was a counterpart of your beloved Frederick Law Olmsted. And so this program runs for a long time, and he held the chair for landscape design since 1991. Instead of now listing hundreds of different awards he won, I just wanted to talk about three things which really were influential, and that's why I invited him to come here. The first one, a part that he also, beside being a professor, had some guest professorships internationally, one in 2004 in Beijing and one in 2007 at UC Berkeley. He always started to work internationally at the big scale. And I think one of the major aspects of his work, that he always collaborated with architects. There was literally no project he didn't work with architects. And instead of talking about his prizes, what made him so strong, most of his projects he got through competition, which is a German tradition. So it's a peer review process. You win the competition and then you do the project. And he has achieved numerous ones of those projects since he started his own office. But the other two things which are really important to note is, first of all, in the 90s, when he educated the first batch of his students, most of those students today are actually the most hippest or contemporary landscape architects in Germany. So they are the ones who are now taking his language and process of design, furthering it and bringing it further. So all the young landscape architects out there in Germany, a lot of them have been through his ringer, through his studios, and are now sort of developing their own ideas. So this is one of his major contributions. But one of his other major contributions is that he also educated professors. I was one of them. I started as an assistant, and in Germany, an assistant is already a trained, registered landscape architect, otherwise you can't teach in Germany. And then I worked my way up to be an adjunct professor, and there were about five or six of us who went through that process, and they are all now in very known universities teaching full time. So his second really amazing aspect of teaching, apart from his students, was he also taught the teachers. So I really appreciated that. And I thought that that's something which is a tradition in Germany, that the professors teach the young, and he did excel in that extremely highly. But apart from that, the final point I want to make, and I think that's really important for you to know, Cornelia Pan Oberlander always says grading is the basis of every landscape architectural project, and I totally agree with her on that, teaching that subject. But I think one of the other things is the plant. And Rainer Schmidt, having studied at Mainz Stefan, which had some of the best plant specialists in Germany, really knows his plants. And even now, he designs city, not so much smaller projects anymore. He has not forgotten to actually think about the plant in his designs. And I think that's something which is always interesting. And I know this because a lot of the former students were always amazed about his incredible plant knowledge. Not just trees, but also herbaceous plants, grasses. So he's really fit in that stuff. And what I find so interesting, even in the projects he's doing now, there is a sensitivity to the plant. And I think that's one important part of landscape architecture we should not forget. To when we do all these large-scale projects, which he's now doing, then we should always think back and consider the basics of landscape architecture. And he's big on that. And finally, I'd like to say he's worked with a lot of very known architects. For example, Helmut Jahn in Chicago, a German architect who has been living for more than 60 years, I think, now in Chicago, one of the major architects on high-rise. So he's been working with those kind of people. So always looking also for the controversial, not just going for the easy design. And I asked him today to talk about his larger projects, specifically because Patrick and I were interested in the new MUD program to introduce big master planning to you. And with no further ado, Rainer, I would like you to come up. But before you come up, I just want to say the title of your talk is City by Landscape, but he's also just published a book, City by Landscape, which you can have a look at later, you can buy it, by Birkhäuser, one of the most prominent architecture, art, and publishing houses in Switzerland, in Zurich. So that's now available. And now, Rainer, please come on. Let's go.
Yeah, Daniel, thank you. Patrick, thank you for your introduction. And today I don't talking about plants. And not talking about big projects. It should talk about cities. That was the invitation to talk about the new program, urban design, talking about cities, city by landscaping. And but I working since my first steps in my career, I working in large scale projects and working with urban design. Why? Urban design means to define the urban spaces between the buildings. And if this urban structure, the spaces are in the good conditions, so this is the first step for a good design for landscape architecture. So urban design is a basic for good landscape architecture. And for the places, for the inhabitants, for the life in these urban spaces. And that is my very important theme. We are working for our people, for the people, for society, living in these urban spaces. And that is very important. So that's city by landscape. But just like coming from the opening of the Bavarian Beer Festival, the Oktoberfest, last Saturday in Munich, our own city, 700,000 square meters, 500,000 visitors per day, own structure with tents, with open spaces, with structure, with diversity, with atmosphere, with morphology, neighborhood, community, identity for a whole region, for a city, with business, best place to make business on this. There are a lot of people and everybody is happy and in a good mood. And that's a perfect city, and it's coming every year. Cities are different in order and structure, in urban grain pattern, and in dynamics, in the logic of growth, and in atmosphere. I have a very Bavarian slang, so that's in English slang, so I have to make the text on the slide, so that's a little bit easier if you don't understand. But so that's the way of my presentation. City landscape give locally respect to topography, soil, water, climate, to the economy and to society, building up on the regional patterns of growth in systems and in places of nature and culture, respecting new tendencies of civilizations. Cities are different in order and structure. Berlin in the time of industrialization with 5 or 4 back courtyards. On the right side, Berlin in the structure of the east part of Germany with the prefabricated plate buildings. With informal and informal structures, cities are different in the logic of growth and the atmosphere. In formal and in informal structures, Johannesburg and London, Mexico City, formal and informal structures. Cities are different in atmosphere and heights and in morphology. I will talk today about the following points: relevant approaches to urban planning, contemporary conditions of urban realities, time-changing conditions for urban spaces, contemporary demands for urban spaces, appropriate places in urban development, task-creating locations, concepts, projects for shaping locations, concept projects for shaping cities, the concept of city by landscape. So the first point, however, neither courage or nor nostalgia, neither wilderness nor the formal restriction of functionalism are relevant to capture the needs of guiding urban changes today. The structural thinking of today's postmodernism is set versus the formalities of modernism. The city is an artificial man-made landscape within which the adventure of our life is unfolded. This said Constant, one office of Netherlands in the 60s. Constant creates a new Babylon, and the international situationists requested that the citizens should take part in decisions-making processes. They should develop a homo faber, the man who making something by rationality, the develop of homo faber towards to homo ludens, the man who create by playing. Before they create a future world, they were analyzing the existing city's results. They mapped the gained experience by means of texts and psychogeographic maps. Constant intended to create a new social and architectural context. Cities are nomadic metropoles under continuous transformation of or gigantic structures within which the individuals can create their personal environment. The spaces are like in a labyrinth and indicate endless possibilities. On this basis, we consider the space become history in transformation, distinguishing for understanding and guiding urban changes, informal and formal growth by lacking design, the manifestation of design philosophies, and both categories might imply values of identities created, emerged by the dedication of meaning of place and nature. Building up on structuralism, we ask how to strengthen the values of culture and ethics in space by offers for future identities. What are the contemporary conditions of urban realities? Every place, the industrial city has become the non-city. Functional grids are lacking a differentiation of spaces. Resulting equities in space have replaced identities of place shaped by the economy and by politics, unbeable for health and happiness. Even with prominent architecture, functional spaces are dominating and lacking a differentiation for staying, enjoying, perceiving. Pollution of air, ground, and water goes along with a continuous immigration from rural to urban conditions in the metropoles, making the living environments unbearable for health and happiness. Growth and decline
are two sides of one coin. The non-city remains a set of individual fragments. Apparently only isolation, no spatial links between elements and systems or between both of them offers for identification. Technical infrastructure carries functionalism for the benefit of motor car traffic and industrial production. Architecture dominates the urban environments functionally and spatially for the benefit of real estate investment and the logic of economic. The time-changing condition for urban spaces. If you look to Cologne, so you have the Roman, medieval, and the pre-industrial urban development phases link spatial elements and systems of nature and culture illogical and economical of by building places like newts in all times, like newts within court cells, providing spaces for further transformations. The early industrial development has created islands like core cells of healthy living conditions with clearly defined spatial offers for identity in place. The industrial generated conglomeration of an industrial region falls back on the individual locations of cities and urban areas in between relics of nature and culture from different periods. And the pre-industrial established core cells still hold the value of location. The core cells are still valid offers for identity in place. Their structural value, urban nodes within meshes of the systems of nature and culture. The modernism in Chicago creating locations by architecture, by points of view related to hierarchy in public spaces and symbols. The postmodernism creating locations by architecture and by symbols. And at present, arts in public space creating a brand for a place. What are the contemporary demands for urban spaces? The 21st century, we have a very strong change in this time from the industrial time to a knowledge-based economy. The mass of industrial workers has been replaced by the mass of footloose individuals in the knowledge-based economy. They can live every place, however, have strong needs for the quality of a healthy living and equally working conditions. Space as offer for identity gains a renaissance in terms of place anchors in local history and continuing the story of area and city and in terms of law implementing the contemporary streams of driving forces in awareness and knowledge about health, technology and ecology. The knowledge-based economy opens up new opportunities for city, the urban open spaces, in elements and systems, with an overall focus on reproducing natural energies and giving access to nature, for example, by opening brooks for meeting in places. The River Isar in Munich, the time of industrialization, the wilderness of the river will be is bringing in a new bed for the river. In this time, look to this tree now. In this time, we have a renaturing of this River Isar to bring the nature back in the city for this new population of this new society. Not only is the population structure changing, but also the relationship between people and the urban open space as an expression of culture and spirit of the time in the postmodernist society. So knowledge workers prefer those places which are appropriate for new ways of living and working. Counterbalancing these conditions for perceiving space and nature in structure, texture, materiality of city, of core cells. Appropriate places in urban development. St. Gallen, unique places of space, of law, highlighting the urban conditions. The whole city gains new identity. So this new permanent surface of streets and squares. History. The Tuileries in Paris, city as a synthesis of individual locations, making up for the overall character of it by use image concept, focusing on movement in place. At present, locations of specific characteristics within the dominating urban tissue continuing to tell the story of the city from past to future. The Parc des Villettes in Paris, location of specific characters within the fine-grained urban tissues reusing former industrial land, continuing to tell the story of the city from past to future. The Parc Citroën, location of specific characteristics, the formal production of the Citroën cars, new elements within existing systems. Task creating location. The mall in London at present. The mall in London in history is future relevance. Innovating use, image and concept by relating place to history, culture, nature, awakening the social and economic logic of space in elements and systems. The new future Almende. Places must have references and features that make them recognizable as home, inviting people to take possession of them to make them appropriate, and thus satisfy people's need for identification. Place, holistic concept for function, space, shape, and atmosphere, use, image, spatial organization through values and strategies. Concept, location as places of space and of flow, for people and for the environment, user, flora and fauna, scale, quality for reproduction, long-term solutions, sustainable in structure and conditions for the society. Values, rarity in structural conditions, cluster, defined units of area and of use, built form and open spaces, integrated systems of natural resources and vegetation, neighborhood units with offers for binding, identification of daily life and work. The Mayor of London, Boris Johnson, by the opening of the London Pavilion, by the MIPIM, the real estate fair in Europe in Cannes, 2012, he said, "We need to bring the village back into our cities." Concepts from project shaping location. Airport Munich. Surface like carpets for arrival and departure. The anchoring of a district in its environment. Its integration into the town must also be made clear in formal relationship. This is a departure, arrival carpet. The idea of reflecting the region, the hilly landscape of Bavaria in artificial outdoor open spaces, combined with fruit trees symbolizing the regional importance of the agriculture and the gravel stone reminding of the natural elements of the Isar Valley, the image of Tuscan landscape around the airport hotel bring identity to this place. Special identification through the landscape. The whole area get expression through the landscape, so city by landscape. Park City Schwabing in Munich. The area concept goes back to the idea of building few connection to the Alps and rebuilding different regional types of gardens in the central park. 40 hectares, that's really 400,000 square meters, a new urban development with a central park in the middle to bring in the identification for the whole area. The feeling of home is created when people from individual relationships with a place, when they appropriate it and it's appropriate by the people in the different theme gardens reflecting the landscape between Munich and the Alps. The agriculture garden, the mountain garden, different theme gardens in this big park, and appropriate by the people, and big pavilions to create space in the inside of this park. Future Park Killesberg in Stuttgart. Urban and rural conditions are equally innovated by telling the story of place new with reference to location and history in place. This area is an old quarry. And the idea was the concept of this park, extending an existing park with importance of garden exhibition during the 1930s, aims to link different residential areas across a major road. It works with the existing topography. Grass pillows are created, paths and open water channels are cut into these artificial hills in order to change the perception of nature. The human is small related to the elevated grass surface, which can eventually be overlooked. The new urban development of both sides, and then comes the park in the middle with a very special structure, gives a strong identity to this place. Brings the place identity of this former quarry into this new urban development, and so it's a very strong place with identification. Hangzhou in China. The client came to us and said to us, you want to have Manhattan. Okay, what is Manhattan? High-rise buildings and central parks. And we decided to make high-rise buildings and central parks. We make green fingers in each of these high-rise buildings. It's back-to-back, the high-rise buildings back-to-back. We have parks, park fingers. Green, back-to-back, green, central park, back-to-back, no new park. So we have all the green fingers. So we combine the stories of Manhattan, and with a strong structure for the greens that tell a story about the water ditches coming down to the river, and then is built in this identity. So home is a word for a specific place with specific features. Home is a combination of the familiar and the strange. The balance between contrasting aspects is a category of home. Home can be part of the public. And this is the main new development in Hangzhou in China, and creating a new placing, a new identity to a city by landscape. How is to shaping a city, a new city, projects for a city? In Ningbo, that is a city with over 3 million inhabitants, and that is a core center, the old core center with 1.5 million inhabitants. And they come to us and we have to make a developing for the next 50 years. And it's the same size as the existing center. That's the existing center. And then we have created a new development for this new part of Ningbo. First the connection, then we have a new center, and we have new structures in this area. We have new green corridors to bring identity and green inside of these new developments. New small clusters with core cells in the middle, with points of identification in the middle of each of these cells, and with a new use center in the middle, and different uses. And for the new center in the middle, we are developing a strong concept, the concept of a normal European city. And there's a big building in the middle, like a castle, or like a city hall, or like a big church. There's a big building in the middle, the big roof with buildings under this roof. Then we have the inner central park, the outer central park, and then we have a wall, like a city wall, but it's a wall with high-rise buildings. And then we have different clusters around with different structures and a green system around. That its place, landscape, and culture come together by this construction. You see green axis through the center, and then different clusters, different units with different identities for identification, for atmosphere. And in the center, the new building as a fixed point for this new development. Guangzhou, 25 square kilometers, over 200,000 new inhabitants in this new development. And we have decided to make something, we make also clusters with core cells in the middle to bring each cluster, bring identity. And then we have a strong system of green corridors divided these parts of the new city in different sizes, and a green middle. The green middle is the green center telling about this former garden and agriculture structure on this place. So we have fields of flowers, fields of plant productions, and this field of plant production is the identity of this new park in the middle. With new buildings, with a new building, with new green buildings, with roof green, with special forms, with sustainable structure. And if we have 2010, this structure of the city, so the future with the green city, sustainable city, the sustainable in sizes, with sustainable structures as a new part of the city. That's the identity from the green fields, the agricultural fields with flower production as an identity in the green park. To appropriate a space means to form a relationship with it, integrate it into one's life, anchor oneself in it, and be the agent of its change by local economies, flower plantages. And special structures for events, for leisure in this new park. Green oasis in Saudi Arabia, a totally new city. And the city is directly in the desert. The thing is that we have water. This is all irrigated fields with a diameter about 200 to 250 meters. And the water is under the sand. And they have decided to make a new city. And we've decided to make different parts in the city. So we have the core center with the infrastructure in the middle. Then we have one element with villas. We have a center with hospitals. We have a leisure part. We have a university part, and we have one of the biggest solar power plants in the world. And the city itself is a living wall around, because the desert is dangerous. The desert is dangerous. We have to protect the whole new city from the desert. And so we have a living wall around. It's our buildings around the whole structure. And that is the whole city in this desert. And inside we have the form of oasis. We have a green garden in the middle. So that's the university. That's a part of the power plant. That is the walled city. Appropriate becomes more intense with the actual and physical seizure of space. The quality here lies in the initiative taken by the inhabitant, experience the walled city as a shelter from the dangers of the desert. And that is a walled city. And inside we have terraces and we have courtyards for living spaces. Chengdu, that's the airport city. The airport city only with offices and production areas with small factories, clean factories, and a big fair in the middle. And we bring this in a green corridor together. The landscape around is just the identity of this city, of this new city with respect all these natural elements like water, groundwater, climate, soil, combining with integrational biotope and environmental management. This new city can bring about demonstrable qualities to interval location to be spread out from these core cells regionally. Open spaces, new core cells in this new city. Competition, we won this competition in the January of this year. Aerobay City in Doha, together with Comparison Fox, And it's also a new city in Qatar. And the entire town, including its surrounding countryside, must be considered as a single large coherent ecosystem and social biotope. Urban planning must take into account all areas of the environment as natural and man-made social biotopes, as system and as core cells. Core cells for the residential part, core cell as a university campus, core cell as a museum in this area, and a leisure park on this. This leisure park is combined with artificial dunes to protect this area for the sand from the desert. And it's a new airport, that's a basic thing. This new airport is a new airport from Qatar for service and for the emir and for the private transportation. That's the core cell of the residential area, integrated the nature with the mangrove in the bay. These areas are for later villas, and we protect these areas with salt. We bring the salt water inside these plots. The salt, the water goes in the atmosphere, and it's retaining the salt and covered the sand and protect the sand for the wind. And the salt pans and the salt park, and this is a residential area. And all this central area without cars, with sustainable structures, with electro buses, with pedestrian areas, with sustainable architecture, with urban open spaces. Modern movement is reconsidered for new synthesis with people and with nature, with city by landscape. Landscape urbanism ultimately suggests neither a few formalism nor a renewed emphasis on landscape in the city. It is not a theory of design, but promises to innovate at the level of design practice. Has emerged from a perceived crisis in which the traditional disciplines of architecture and urbanism are thought to be incapable of engaging the contemporary built environment. We're going from rural to urban, from unbuilt to built in our time. City by landscape deals with nature and culture by new images and holistic concepts according to the characters and dynamics of spaces. The creation, continuation, and renewal of responsive environments are perceivable in places where the grammar of space is enriched or where new contexts are defined. New contexts are opened up to serve for humans and for nature by branding nature in place. Green shows us where to find nourishment in a favorable biotope. Nature represents roots and home throughout all phases of transformation, in the nature, but also in new developments, like here in Yongsan in Seoul, the new exhibition of high-rise buildings, and we are creating this part, and one of this part for identity, this park is a nature, it's a green around, the special concept about this, and bring city by landscape to this part. City by landscape is a holistic approach running through all relevant topics and policy areas for a horizontal networking within the level involved, for vertical networking between these levels, for strategic planning at citywide level by means of an integrated urban development concept, a holistic approach for linking the integrated approach to an area-based approach, for spatial perspective for social cultural aims, for linking the integrated approach to inclusion, people, environment, culture, nature, and the economy. Thank you.
I open the floor for questions. If anybody has any questions, please fire away.
said something about preventing sun. Did you expand on it?
Protected Sun.
Wie das Salz den Sand.
Oh, that's also fresh. Okay, so that's you put it the salt water in this plots. The plots are deeper, and then the evaporation of the water goes in the atmosphere. So it's retaining the salt as a not insulation. No, it's like an edge over the sand,
like a layer
over sand.
It protects it against the
and so it protects the salt. So it protects the sand for the wind, and we integrate in this different bacteria. So this salt is like green or like red. So that's very interesting. So we're creating a salt park.
I have a question.
Now, we invited you intentionally to talk about the big projects. The question I have is on the scale of the buildings. What is your thought on the scale of the buildings? Are you for or against high-rise? Some of your projects show smaller scale and courtyard design and intertwining design, and some of them show quite gigantic, big high-rise buildings. I would love to know from you, you've worked on so many big city projects with very known architects, what is your personal standpoint of view on the large-scale building or the small-scale human?
It depends on the location. That's where we are. So in the discussion, it's clear that the high-rise building is the same population as a one-story structure in the area.
Yeah.
That's correct. High-rise buildings. In this time, at the point of especially in South America or China, a form of privacy. Because they are safe. You have some control in the basement, and in our times, especially in Mexico and in Rio de Janeiro, all the villas are empty because the inhabitants are anxious about the situations, and they go in the high rise buildings because they are safe in this. One point for the population. Second point, high-rise buildings, the look from the high-rise building down the landscape is wonderful. And I like it. I like it to live in the upper floor of a high-rise building, and I am the little god, huh? Looking over the city and over landscape and so on. And this is, or being in the clouds, that's a special event. And it's a condition of good life. So other sides, a villa with a garden, especially as me, as a gardener, a villa with a garden, it's wonderful. Living, have the plants in front of the windows, going out and smells the earth. So that's from the normal human point, is to live in a smaller dimension. It is more human. It is more human, and it's more. So in this point, that's depend of the situation, and if you are in the dense city and you are outside, but it's depend of the location, and then you have to decide what is the right way for the structure of the city.